welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from John Russell and Jill Robbins. Then Bryan Lynn has some helpful tips for keeping your password safe in this week's technology report. Finally, we hear the lesson of the day. But first, here is John Russell.
Scientists have confirmed a cave on the moon, not far from where Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin landed 55 years ago. They suspect there are hundreds more that could house future astronauts. An Italian-led team reported recently that there is evidence of a large cave that can be entered from the deepest known pit on the moon. It is located at the Sea of Tranquility, just 400 kilometers from Apollo 11's landing site. The pit, like the more than 200 others discovered there, was created by the collapse of a lava tube. Researchers examined radar measurements by NASA's Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter and compared the results with lava tubes on Earth. Their findings appeared in the scientific publication Nature Astronomy. The radar data shows only the beginning part of the underground area, the scientists say. They estimate it is at least 40 meters wide and tens of meters long, probably more. Lunar caves have remained a mystery for over 50 years, so it was exciting to be able to finally prove the existence of one, Leonardo Carrer and Lorenzo Bruzzoni of Italy's University of Trento wrote in an email. Most of the pits seem to be in the moon's ancient lava plains, scientists say. There also could be some at the moon's south pole, the planned location of NASA's astronaut landings in the years to come. Permanently shadowed craters there are believed to hold frozen water that could provide drinking water and rocket fuel. During NASA's Apollo program, 12 astronauts landed on the moon, beginning with Armstrong and Aldrin on July 20th, 1969. The findings suggest there could be hundreds of pits on the moon and thousands of lava tubes. Such places could serve as a natural shelter for astronauts, protecting them from cosmic rays and solar radiation, as well as from very small meteorite strikes. The act of building living areas from nothing would be more difficult and take more time, even when including the possible need of strengthening the cave walls to prevent a collapse, the team said. Rocks and other material inside these caves, unchanged by the difficult surface conditions over the ages, also can help scientists better understand how the moon evolved, especially in terms of its volcanic activity. I'm John Russell.
No one has ever seen a live spade-toothed whale. It is the world's rarest kind of whale. No one knows how many exist, what they eat, or even where they live in the southern Pacific Ocean. However, scientists in New Zealand may finally get to learn more about them. The country's conservation agency said Monday it believes a dead spade-toothed whale washed up on a South Island beach earlier this month. Scientists identified the whale by its color patterns and the shape of its skull, beak, and teeth. Hannah Hendricks is a sea life expert for the Department of Conservation. She said, "This is going to lead to some amazing science and world-first information." In the past, only a few other spade-toothed whales have appeared on New Zealand's beaches. Scientists did not have a chance to closely examine them. Now they will be able to. They have moved the whale to a cold place for their investigation. Researchers will work with local Maori iwi, or tribal groups, to plan how to examine the whale, the conservation agency said. New Zealand's indigenous people consider whales a taonga, a sacred treasure. In April, Pacific indigenous leaders signed a treaty recognizing whales as legal persons. However, that is not recognized in the laws of participating nations. Spade-toothed whales live deep in the ocean. They come to the surface so rarely that scientists only know their general location in the southern Pacific Ocean. It is home to some of the world's deepest ocean areas, Hendricks said. It is very hard to do research on marine animals if you don't see them at sea, she said. You don't know where to look. Kirsten Young is a senior lecturer at Britain's University of Exeter. She studies spade-toothed whales. She wrote in an email that it took many years and a mammoth amount of effort by researchers and local people to identify the whales. The new discovery makes me wonder, how many are out in the deep ocean, and how do they live? Young said. Researchers studying the mammal could not confirm if the species went extinct. Then, in 2010, two whole spade-toothed whales, both dead, appeared on a New Zealand beach. Samples of their tissue later showed they were spade-toothed whales. I'm Jill Robbins.
For most of us, using and trying to remember a collection of passwords is just a normal part of our digital lives. But it seems like the number of passwords we need for online activities just gets bigger and bigger. Some passwords, especially for work-related systems, must be changed often. That makes passwords even harder to create and remember. These difficulties can lead some people to reuse passwords to help simplify the process. But most security experts warn against this. Reusing passwords can make it easier for internet attackers or hackers to digitally seize personal accounts. One of the most suggested methods for effectively dealing with passwords is to employ a separate product called a password manager. These tools are not new. You have probably already heard of such tools and might have even tried one. Here are some tips for deciding whether a password manager might be right for you. The general idea behind password managers is simple. Your passwords are stored securely in a digital vault. When you need to use a particular online service, the manager automatically enters login details and password fields for you. The U.S. government's Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency notes, "When we use a password manager, we only need to remember one strong password, the one for the password manager itself. Most password managers have a smartphone service or app that works with internet browsers and other apps. This means they can be set to open with a fingerprint or face identification. If on a computer, you can also sign into your password vault through a browser tool called a plugin or by going to a website. A good password manager should be able to create complex passwords using letters, numbers, and special characters when setting up a new account. And it should also recognize that you are signing in to an online service for the first time and ask if you want to save the information you have entered. Password managers can also protect against so-called phishing attempts. These usually appear as emails seeking to trick users into clicking onto a link to a false website designed to capture login details. A password manager can prevent such details from automatically being filled in if the web address is not the same as the one linked to the saved password. Most password managers can store other information as well, such as bank and credit card PINs. Many also support passkeys, a new technology that companies like Google have launched as a safer method than passwords. There are many different password managers on the market. Some of the best-known systems include 1Password, Bitwarden, Dashlane, Bitdefender, NordPass, Keeper, and KeepPass. One of the best ways to choose the right manager is to look at online reviews based on professional testing and ratings. Britain's National Cybersecurity Center has also established a buyer's guide to help users choose the right password manager. Most services have free and paid versions. The free offerings come with restrictions, such as permitting only one device to be signed in at a time or limiting the number of passwords to store. Top-rated managers work across different devices and services with apps for Windows and Mac computers, as well as iOS and Android devices. And plugins can be downloaded for browsers like Chrome, Safari, Firefox, Edge, Brave, and Opera. Apple also has its own keychain service for Macs and iOS devices. Good password managers use strong encryption methods that aim to prevent any other parties from seeing your data. Peter Arnst is a security researcher at California-based cybersecurity company Malwarebytes. He told the Associated Press that many password managers use the most secure kind of encryption available. Arnst noted this kind of encryption can protect users even when their computers, devices, or password managers are hacked. This is because encryption ensures the saved passwords are stored in an encoded state. This means the attacker would need to know the main password in order to read any of the saved passwords. I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn joins me now to talk more about his technology report. Thanks for being here, Bryan.
Of course, Ashley. Glad to be here.
This week, you looked at how password managers can help people deal more effectively with multiple passwords needed for online activities. One thing you mentioned was a passkey, a new technology that might replace passwords altogether. What can you tell us about passkeys?
Yes, so this is, as you say, a much newer technology than password managers. Major tech companies like Google, Apple, and Microsoft have been working together on this technology for several years with the goal of coming up with a widely used passkey system to remove the need for passwords. And these can already be used if the user follows the steps to create a passkey for certain websites.
And how do passkeys work compared to passwords or password managers?
So a passkey is a kind of digital marker stored on your computer or device, and it can be used to unlock any online account you have. The passkey uses biometrics to identify the user, for example, through a fingerprint, face scan, or screen lock, personal identification number, or PIN. Passkeys establish a secure connection between a computer or device and a cloud service, such as Apple's iCloud, for example. This technology uses the same secure encryption methods as brought up in the report, but adds another layer of security. And the cloud service keeps an encrypted copy of the digital marker that identifies the user. Now, when using passkeys, no password ever has to be created. Experts have said passkey technology is definitely where things are moving, and the tech is considered very secure. The problem is that currently not many websites are set up to handle passkeys.
All right. Thanks again for being here, Bryan, and thank you for that helpful and informative report.
You're welcome. Thank you.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Jill Robbins, and I'm joined by Andrew Smith. Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Jill. Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello. My name is Anna Mateo.
On today's podcast lesson, we're going to listen to Lesson 16 of Level 2 of Let's Learn English. This lesson repeats, many times, two ways we can talk about things we did or experienced on a regular or habitual basis in the past.
A habitual basis means things that happened on a kind of regular schedule, or that happened very often.
For example, if you go to school 5 days a week, that is a habitual action.
Now, here are the two ways we can talk about habitual actions, feelings, or states of being in the past. The first way uses the modal would. The second way uses the two words used to.
The best way to learn to use them is to hear some examples. Listen to the beginning of lesson 16.
Hi, Kaveh. Let's go to lunch.
Ooh, I know a great place. When I first started working here, I would go every day.
Great. Oh, no.
What's wrong?
I lost my key. I just had it this morning.
You should check the lost and found office.
Great idea. Where is it?
Oh, it used to be across from the cafeteria, but now it's down in the basement next to the elevators. It's really hard to find.
The lost and found is hard to find. That's funny.
It is.
You can hear the first habitual action when Kaveh says,
"Ooh, I know a great place. When I first started working here, I would go every day."
And then Kaveh talks about another situation that existed for a period of time in the past.
Oh, it used to be across from the cafeteria.
Here, the words used to be just mean the same thing as the verb was.
There are some small differences in how we use the modal would and the verb used to when we describe habitual past actions or experiences. Here's Professor Bott explaining these differences.
I hope Anna can find the lost and found office. Used to and would describe something that happened repeatedly in the past. Kaveh uses would when he says,
"When I first started working here, I would go every day."
There are two differences between used to and would. Number one, we use would only when we say the time period first. Number two, for verbs like be, think, feel, see, and understand, we can only use used to. Kaveh says,
"It used to be across from the cafeteria."
Thanks, Professor Bott. That is a helpful explanation. Verbs such as be, think, feel, see, and understand are more like states of mind or states of being, rather than actions, such as the verbs go, eat, play, and so on. Now, listen to Jill and I have a conversation about our past. Listen for how we use would and used to.
Andrew, do you have any special memories of something you would do with your family when you were young?
I do. Yes, I do. So one example is from the age of 11 until about the age of 18, I would go with my father every year to the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. That's in the southeastern United States. And we would hike up a mountain called Mount LeConte. At the top of the mountain, there were cabins where we would spend the night. And I remember I would get up very early in the morning and go watch the sunrise from the top of the mountain. Those are special memories. How about you, Jill?
My family used to travel around the country in a Volkswagen bus. When I was little, all seven of us would sleep in this big blue tent. My dad once said he wanted us to see all parts of the country, so we went there and camped. I think that's where I got my love for traveling to new places and meeting people from other places.
That sounds so great. I think I would have loved to do that. Maybe I'll get a van when I'm older and try to do something similar.
Now let's hear more from Lesson 16 of Level 2 of Let's Learn English. Anna goes to an office to try to find her lost key. The person in the office thinks Anna wants to find the key to happiness instead of a key to her door. In this part, you will hear many examples of the words used to, when the speakers describe habitual actions and feelings from the past.
Come in. I am Serenity.
Hi, Serenity. I'm Anna.
Please, sit down. How can I help you?
I lost something very important.
Shh. I already know. You need help.
Yes, I need help finding the key.
You need to find the key. The key that will give you happiness.
Yes, finding this key will make me very happy.
First, Anna, let me tell you a little bit about myself.
Okay.
I used to be a very important person with a very important job. I made a lot of money. I mean a lot.
Wow, good for you.
No, it was bad for me. I lost the most important thing, the key. You've lost it too, haven't you, Anna? Haven't you?
I guess. So how does this work? Do I have to fill out a form or something, or?
No forms. Just answer this one question. As a child, what did you used to do to feel happy?
When I was little, I used to sing all the time with my family. Those were good times.
Singing is so joyful. I used to sing. But now that I started my business, I've just been too busy. Too busy. Anna, why don't you sing again?
I sing everywhere. I sing in the office, I sing on the metro, I sing in the elevators, I sing on the escalators, I sing in the bathroom. Serenity, serenity, I really need to find my key.
Yeah. Yes, we need to find the key to happiness.
No, I just need to find the key to my apartment.
I used to know, but now I don't. Do you, Anna?
I don't know. I think I left it in the ladies' room. You know, this isn't the lost and found, is it?
It could be the lost and found. I'm lost. And I used to find joy for people. I used to find joy.
You know, this is a bad time for you. I'll find the lost and found myself. Bye, thanks.
I used to find joy. I used to find joy. I used to find joy.
I found my key.
I used to find joy.
Oh, the sad woman in the office used to find joy. Well, hopefully she will find it again soon.
Listeners, what are some things you used to do when you were younger? What would you do when you played with your friends? Write to us and let us know.
You can send your email to learningenglish@voanews.com.
Remember, you can always find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.